So it's time to start this third lesson of the course of Ethics and AI organized by the Italian Society for the Ethics of Artificial Intelligence. I'm Guido Boella. I'm a computer scientist working in AI, but I also have a background in philosophy. The course is titled Ethics and AI, Non-Ethics of AI, because we want to consider also another aspect of the problem, another side of the problem, not just the application of ethics of AI to the field of AI, where ethics is the discipline in philosophy that Professor Mori described you in the previous lessons. This is an application of ethics and a new field of application of ethics that we also want to describe in this lesson how AI itself, by changing our society, our knowledge, our world, affects ethics itself, and maybe we have to make some changes. We will not talk in this lesson about machine ethics, a field where I worked in the past, and also Professor Sartor is working because he's very, let's say, specialistic. Should we have an applied ethics to AI? Because it's not straightforward that there is a necessity. We have to understand which is the problem created by AI, where are the risks, how to face them, and how, whether and how AI is different from other technologies from the ethical point of view, and it requires a special treatment. But we start with a warning. Algorithm Watch, which is non-profit advocacy group about AI, warns us that there are hundreds of guidelines about ethics of AI, ethical approaches to AI, so. But they are largely ineffective. Ethical guidelines are not effective because they are not, cannot be clearly implemented, there is not enough specificity, no technical personnel, they are very vague, there are no enforcement mechanisms, they merge together different principles. So they look more like a public relation effort, and they don't stop the problems they want to address. And even, let's say, more official guidelines like the one of the Association of Electronic and Electric Engineers, IEEE, fails to be effective and is not adopted by the largest companies. So, given this warning, today we will talk about bias and classification, explainability, autonomy, but also the rhetoric used by big players about AI. We talk about economics and the impact of AI in the society. Bias. So, you know, bias is this systematic problem in the results that seems to be affected by prejudices, in particular in machine learning applications. But, for example, there are many, many examples nowadays. One of the first was the hiring system set up by Amazon that at some point was plagued by the fact that it was rejecting CVs by female candidates. Why? Simply because the system was trained on the CVs of the employees of Amazon that at the time were mostly male. And so this distortion in the data set has been reflected in the results. But how Rua Benjamin says, it's fantasy to think that feeding AI systems, giving data to the machine learning system, including the words beauty, but also ugliness and even cruelty, can be, it is fantasy to expect that only beauty, only what we would like to have, emerges from the learning. So there are several consequences of this bias problem. First of all, the quality of the results. You can miss some results that you would like to have. You obviously have a negative effect on the user, on the subject on which these tools are used, because they are discriminated from the decision support system. They are not hired. They are not given a loan because they are poor. There are also the psychological effects, because they can feel discriminated if you an AI natural language processing system proposes racial assertions. Obviously, the people involved can be offended or worse. Then there is the opposite problem of proselytism. For example, in the autocomplete of a search engine can propose racist content. For a while, Google, if you type shirt, would propose black shirt in the sense of the fascist uniform. But worst of all, there is the problem that it bias in some system create a feedback loop reinforcing the bias in the data, because some system creates new data, natural language processing generating text, or an hiring personnel, a system for hiring personnel, hiring more male employees, adding more male CVs to the training, to the learning corpus. So it creates a self-reinforcing bias in the society. And this is the topic of the famous book by Katie O'Neill, Weapons of Mass Destruction, which is a suggested reading. Still in the problem of bias, in particular in machine learning for natural language processing, we have to mention the famous case of Timnit Gebru and Margaret Mitchell, two top scientists at Google. Both in the ethical committee that have been recently fired by Google. You all read about this in the newspaper. You probably didn't read the paper that caused them to be fired, which is on the danger of stochastic parrots, which says much. And this is really a denunciation of the technologies of Google about NLP, which are, I guess, a big share of the functioning of Google, from search to personalized advertisement and so on. And it is important to read one of the sections of this article called The Unfathomable Training Data, where unfathomable, I had to look at the dictionary, means incapable of being fully explored or understood. Divided in four subsections. First, we have terabytes of data, but they are not enough to guarantee diversity, because diversity is expressed probably not on Facebook, but on specialized blogs and so on, and different channels than the mainstream. So they remain outside. Then there is an important consideration on the fact that social views changes continuously, but the data are static, the data fed to the machine learning. Moreover, this combines with the previous point that when diversity, new social views emerge, they emerge not in the main channels that are collected in the data. Take, for example, the Me Too movement, the Black Lives Matter movement. Then there is the fact that of the content of the bias inside the training set, which is what we said before, but there is a clear denunciation of the fact that Google doesn't foresee at all a budget to curate, document the data. And so even if there are some tools removing offending words automatically and little more, there is no curation. Also because we want unsupervised systems, because they can leverage a huge amount of data. So it will be very difficult to and expensive to look for bias in the training set. But then there is another issue. Even if you would have the budget to curate the data, still you should at some point make some political choices, because you cannot put all the different positions there are within a corpus without creating confusion. And in particular, one political decision is the one to look at the status quo ante or at the future. If you use only mainstream data, the data are old, the data are partials, so you risk that the most innovative systems in reality are quite conservative, having learned the past and not the present, which is quite a strong assertion. Finally, even if this does not concern, strictly speaking, the problem of bias, they make another very strong assertion. They said our system at Google can manipulate linguistic form. They are cheating. They are good enough to cheat it through tests of natural language understanding, but in reality they are not understanding anything, because they rely heavily on the fact that the coherence is in the eye of the beholder. We as humans are by nature looking at the meaning, at the intention, reconstructing the intention, looking at the context, attributing a mental state at the people we are talking to. And while these systems do not absolutely try to understand what is in the mind of their interlocutor, they simply collect more and more data, enough to find, via a sort of pattern matching, an answer to everything. But they say, in reality, they are only stitching together of linguistic forms observed in the vast training data. They are just stochastic parrots. You see, this from the two top scientists of Google, this is a very, very strong assertion. And they even say that Google and the other players relying on tools for on machine learning, on big data, they are ruining the research community, because they are compelling us as scientists to follow them. We don't have even the means to do that, because the systems to be trained required hundreds of thousands of dollars, if not millions. And so it is a very strong denunciation that didn't appear so much in the newspapers, and this paper is really worth watching, reading. And paradoxically, it seems that the denunciation made at the beginning of AI in the 60s by Joseph Weizenbaum, one of the founders of AI, that provocatively created ELIZA, as simple natural language processing tool based on pattern matching, mocking to be a Rogerian psychologist, and in reality, don't creating apparently coherent conversations, but without any meaning, without any understanding. And in a hugest scale, this is what is happening today with these systems. But given this fact that we attribute mental attitudes, even emotions to our interlocutors when we talk, and so when we talk in written text, when we chat with a computer, imagine what could be the risk with other forms where you have robotics, humanoid robotics, where we are, by even visual clues, forced to attribute mental attitudes, emotion to machines that do not have anything such that, even if in some cases, like in the famous toy seal, they can be of some help for example, people with degenerative mental diseases. If you want to read more outside the scientific context, take the latest novel by Kazuo Ishiguro, the British Nobel Prize writer, Clara and the Sun, because it is on strictly on these topics. And another suggestion, if you want to have a sort of mental experiment of how far we can go in the trade-off between the trade-off between the advantage for us, but the damage to the greater good, read Never Let Me Go by the same author, even if it is on biotechnologies and not on ICT. Then, coming back strictly to bias and using the words of Kate Crawford in her recent book, Atlas of AI, well, we said the term bias refers to this systematic classification error in machine learning. But, Kate Crawford says, is not enough. Then maybe we cannot, we could even, we should be aware that bias is not the right term, because bias has many other meanings. It is referred to, for example, in law, to preconceived notion and opinion, to prejudice. It has a different meaning in psychologies related to systematic errors in human judgments. It is about also our unconscious attitudes. So bias is not a technical error, and it cannot be solved simply by improving the algorithm, because it relies on the form of discrimination that are in the data set, as we said. So for Crawford, maybe the term itself, bias, is misleading, because it is not the whole problem. Bias seems to reduce everything to a technical problem that can be solved by improving the algorithm. She also says that the problem relies in something else, and not on the bias, on the process of classification. The problem rests in the classification itself, because these systems are classifying, but we are not much aware of the problems behind classification itself, even if it is biased or not. Classification, you must be aware that classification is a form of power, of centralized power, deciding which differences make a difference. Moreover, these classifications disappear. We are not aware that we are classifying the world in some way. They are taken for granted, and while at the same time they are influencing, they are a sort of political intervention that naturalizing a particular ordering on the world, which is not natural, but has been chosen by someone. And this is clear, for example, in the data set ImageNet, which is one of the biggest data set of images available for scientists. And the images are obviously labeled according to what set of label. They have chosen, the University of Stanford, they have chosen WordNet, an ontology, a database of words, made by the Princeton University. But if you just look at the 9 top-level categories of WordNet, you can be probably puzzled. They range from plant to fungus to animal to person. So there is no ordering, no rationale, which is what our mental classification does, even again to make a reference to art, to literature. Read the famous novel by Jorge Luis Borges about the Chinese encyclopedia, in which you see that the categories in which it is organized look really crazy, but in reality they are not much different from what our mind does, according to the psychologist, cognitive scientist George Lakoff. Moreover, an ontology like WordNet has many, many hidden assumptions. In particular, take an example. If you take adult body, it has only 2 categories, female and male bodies. So it seems to introduce an implicit assumption that the only 2 natural form of bodies are male and female, and this propagates onto the overall training set and obviously creates a bias when the system is used. Moreover, there is another problem besides selecting just 2 categories or whatever number, that they are allocating people into gender, race, identity, or whatever, without their consent. While many categorizations concerning identity are chosen by people, so they cannot be imposed. And Kate Crawford makes a warning, mind that for centuries administrative systems has just did this, imposing fixed set of categories, creating forms of violence and oppressions. ImageNet is an open source dataset. We don't know what is inside the huge proprietary datasets of big companies, and so we don't know anything about the potential biases. Moreover, images, but even all the other data, have all sorts of potential meaning, irresolvable questions, contradictions. So resolving these ambiguities means simplifying complexities. And there is someone who is in power to choose and to select these categorization, and thus imposing their own order in the world. So as you see, the problem of bias is not simply a technical problem, and it has far-fetched implications for the society. and for the power structures in our world. A related topic is the one of emotion recognition. Many image recognition systems nowadays are able, or claim to be able, also to recognize emotions. But again, this is a troublesome problem from the ethical point of view. First, again, it can the data sets used, even if they are tagged manually, differently than in other domains, they have problems because the psychological theories that are used to instruct the people labeling images are not commonly accepted by the scientific community. In particular, many works refer to the work of Paul Ekman, a famous psychologist, then devised a set of primitive universal features that our faces have when expressing emotions. And even if there is a huge literature against this scientific point of view, still it is widely used in many contexts. Moreover, there is a second issue that was mentioned in some slides I skipped before, is the sort of digital epidermalization, it is called by Simone Brown. The fact that issues like identity, race, and in this case, emotions, are considered as biological categories that can be recognized from our faces, from our expression, even if they are not biological categories. They should be understood as politically, culturally, and socially constructed. So there is a big risk in these technologies, considered also in the way emotion recognition is used. For example, to recognize suspect terrorists in airports because someone looked stressed, and so probably going to commit a terrorist act. But for example, in China, they are going farther. They are using it to understand whether children are attentive at school, or even if people is showing positive energy, which is something that can be obviously criticized by itself, but even more if their foundations are criticized at the scientific level. The article in The Guardian refers to a system made by Nesta UK, a think tank, called emojify.me, that is given to people to understand the hidden complexities of emotion recognition in an advocacy effort to make people aware of the risks where we are going to. Another suggestion, not reading, but watching, is the recent movie Coded Bias, concerning many of the problems we just mentioned. The image here is given by the fact that the MIT researcher that discovered that the mainstream image face recognition systems were biased, having more trouble in recognizing people with darker skins, has been noticed by her when she put a white mask on top of her face, and the computer start recognizing much better her face with the mask than without it. In the movie is also acting Virginia Eubanks, the author of another book worth reading, Automating Inequality, studying how these systems create the feedback loop I was mentioning before, putting disadvantaged people more in trouble. For example, one classical example is the one of systems to decide where crime is likely to happen and sending their police patrols. But crimes happen in poorest neighborhoods, usually. If you put more police patrols in poorest neighbors, you find more crime, and when you feed the data to the system, the next time we'll send you again in that poor neighbor, and so forth, so on, so forth. Another complex issue concerning machine learning from the ethical point of view is the one of explainability. We don't know, neural networks are to some degree black boxes. We don't know how they work, which relations they create inside them from the training set. So one idea is that these systems should be explainable, should give a justification of what they are doing. For example, creating discriminations due to their biases. The Amazon hiring system should have said, I reject this CV because it is of a female candidate. It wasn't able to do it, and it took a while to Amazon to understand and to dismiss the system. This idea is so popular that it already 5 years ago made its way in the famous GDPR regulation, the General Data Protection Regulation of European Union, that imposes suitable safeguards to, in particular, a right to obtain explanation of the decision reached after such assessment and to challenge the decision, which is another important problem. The issue of explainability is addressed in detail in Everyday Chaos, a book by David Weinberger. And it is of extreme importance because if you even take AlphaGo, the system playing not chess but the Chinese game Go, and winning everyone, including the desperate KGA world champion, these top players, when beaten by the system, but the same for chess players, says has the impression to play with an alien. So the reasoning inside this system is completely different from one of humans. And so here is the problem. The question, is it really possible to have system, AI, machine learning systems that are able to explain what they are doing? And there are several problems in answering this question. The problem is, what is an explanation? Do we have really a theory as humans of our human explanations? Are we really able to give explanations of many times we are just giving conscious reconstructions of an unconscious reasoning, maybe also to save our face? Then there is the huge problem of tacit knowledge, the term invented by the Hungarian economist Michael Polanyi. Our knowledge is divided in explicit knowledge, the one that can be given verbally that can be expressed in logic, and tacit knowledge, the one that is tacit. You cannot talk about it because it is not conscious, is not reachable by our consciousness, and so it is not explainable in words. For example, you cannot learn to go by bicycle or to ski simply reading a book, and you cannot teach without making experiments in practice, and so on and so forth. But even reasoning, even our language ability are tacit knowledge. We talk, but we don't know the rule. We reason, but we don't know what is a logical proof till we have a logic course at the computer science or mathematics degree. So there are reasons in principles for saying that maybe explainability cannot be reached. Then there are reasons in practice. These huge deep learning systems have hundreds of trillions of nodes in their neural network. How to explore the dependencies among them? How you can understand that a given very small dependence added to the overall result? Then, like for humans, there is the problem of trusting the machine. Why an enterprise should tell you the truth? Take the example of Amazon. Rather than dismissing the hiring system, maybe they could have done another system faking explanation. So the female CV has been rejected for some reason. Maybe the CV, the result of the computer architecture was not so good, but it's just a pretext because Amazon is satisfied, in this hypothetical example, is satisfied by their hiring system, even if it discriminates female candidates. So how can we trust machine explanation, especially when, like for the data set above, they are trade secrets? We cannot pretend to look inside, even if we were able to understand what is inside, if we could look at them. Then there is the main argument of the book of Weinberger. Our conceptual models are probably simplifications of a complex reality. They have worked well. We have evolved in a million years, and we are coping well. But now what is happening? The world itself is much more complex than a century ago. Our needs are much more complex to be satisfied. So we need something more to understand and to act in these worlds. And it could be that these deep learning systems, digesting trillions of bytes of examples, are understanding, are capturing connections that are hidden to our simplified models. So we are, says Weinberger, probably in a paradoxical world where our mental system has not the same performances of artificial systems, obviously in selected domains, not fall in the general AI discussion, generalized AI discussion. They have better performances, but they are not able, in principle, to be explained because they don't use the same kind of simplifications that we humans, much more computationally constrained, have been forced to use by the evolution. So, if explainability is a strict requirement for an ethical use of AI, we could be in serious trouble. Not to talk about the problem of reproducibility crisis, where sometimes these black boxes systems, when they are described, are not reproducible by scientists. But we stop here concerning the problem plugging machine learning systems from the ethical point of view. And we have a brief mention to another obvious problem from the ethical point of view: autonomous vehicles, that is, self-driving cars. We obviously could talk for hours about these problems, about the trade-offs between the possible positive effects of automated cars with respect to the current situation, also from the economical point of view. But I would like to focus to a specific problem, the so-called trolley problem. From the ethical point of view, one of the trickiest issues when talking about automated systems, and in particular automated vehicles, is the one depicted in this drawing. You have a trolley which is without control. You are the unlucky guy who has to make a choice to pull a lever and shift the trajectory of the trolley in a way that, rather than going straight and killing and people, it kills one, or anyway, less than N people. Obviously, no one of us would like to be in that position. There is no clear-cut solution to this problem. The utilitarian solution cannot be always used, and maybe people would not use it in practice due to their cognitive biases we were mentioning before. But seems to be a serious problem for a self-driving car. Should the car kill the pedestrian in front of it, or should it steer the wheel and crash the car, probably endangering the life of the driver who bought the car? Who knows? They know instead, because you all remember the tragic accident of the Uber car in Arizona some years ago that killed the unfortunate lady who was crossing a big avenue with her bike, pushing the bike. So this is the cars. At some point, identified that there was a risk. So it was not a problem of image recognition. What was the problem, according to the National Transportation Safety Board, the agency who made the investigation, is that Uber programmers, engineers, decided to switch off the automated braking system, the emergency braking system, when the computer is in control, to reduce the potential for erratic vehicle behavior, which means not to disturb the passengers with having a back and forth movement due to abrupt braking that were not always justified by the risk. So you see, philosophers identify problems, engineers solve them without resorting to philosophers. So something that in principle seem very very troublesome for the success of self-driving car, in reality has been, in practice, has been solved in other ways by the engineers. Not suggesting that was the right solution. I'm simply saying that there is still a huge distance between ethical guidelines and what is the trade-offs chosen by engineers and by their employers when they are developing new products. Then there is the huge topic of automated weapons with a sub-problem. Maybe automated weapons will not arrive soon, but the human pilots deciding to launch a missile and kill some people already rely on data that are the result of AI. So the last step of taking the decision of sending a bomb in reality is not the major problem, because already there are problems in that these pilots on the ground cannot but rely on the interpretation of data given by AI system. Not to mention the psychological problems of killing people while seeing with no risk for themselves and looking almost to play video games, like this photograph shows. We don't have time to have a look at this video called Slaughterbots, again from an advocacy group on AI, but it is worth watching later for you. Then I would like to introduce briefly another issue, the one of rhetoric. And now I have an exercise for you, and I need a reply from you. By the way, I left unsaid, but for me it was natural. Just stop me and intervene whenever you want to say something. Don't even ask permission in the chat. So we have here two sentences. Grammatically, they have exactly the same structure. The brown stink bug, which is that annoying insect that ends up burning against our lamps, producing a horrible smell. The brown stink bug will substitute the local green stink bug in our countryside. The other sentence has the same structure, a subject, the verb will substitute someone somewhere. The robots will substitute humans in the workplaces. You probably read the first, or no, the first sentence, which is true from a scientific point of view. The second sentence, you probably read many more times, but you didn't notice that the second sentence has no meaning. The second sentence is not correct. It is grammatical because it has the same grammatical structure of the first sentence, but it is not meaningful. Even if, as I said, it appears dozens, hundreds of times in newspapers. So think a moment and try to understand what's wrong with the second sentence. It doesn't mean that it's not true. Maybe it's true. It is debatable. Some people claim it will end in this way. Some other people say no. But still, we can understand the sentence, even if it is not meaningful. Why? Okay, this is a these two sentences as a, are a dirty trick to show the dirty tricks that enterprises or maybe also scientists use when they try to present their vision of the world as positive for you, as inevitable for you. Inevitable is a suggestion for understanding the puzzle. Ilaria, because no, 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 it's you are far away. Your answer
Good
is
afternoon.
on the. Sorry, not. The answer of Ilaria is about whether the sentence is true, and she's right. Probably robots will not substitute humans in every job. But here the problem is different, is that the sentence, true, maybe not, but is not meaningful. Please.
My point on the differences is more about the actors in the sentences, meaning that if we compare the brown steam bugs and the green steam bug, basically the only thing that we can state that changes is the color of their skin and their aspect. But when it comes to
No.
humans and robot, they are mainly different.
No. No, no, no. You are very far away. But you said something right. Agent. Agent is part of the solution.
Good evening.
Please.
I think that the brown stink bug will substitute the local green stink bug because it will provoke an extinction.
Yes.
Instead, the robots will help humans in workplaces. There will be other works for humans.
No, that's not the problem. Someone else want to try? The two suggestions were agent, the term agent, and the goal of conveying inevitability. So we have some proposals in the chat. David, robot. Parable to human, that's not the problem. Bruno, maybe because it will be humans that replace humans with robots. Right. Bruno, the idea is that exactly that robots will not substitute no one. Okay, take an industrial robot is not kicking the butt of the worker out of the factory. There is someone, the owner of the factory, buying robots from some industries and installing it in the workplace that was before occupied by a human. So the real sentence is industrials will substitute humans with robots in the work in the workplaces, while the brown stink bug has an evolutionary advantage. I don't know why, but probably it eats less, produce more than the green bug, stink bug, so it will overtake as a natural process the other one. Robots don't do anything. Robots just turn screws and that's it. So why newspapers use the second sentence? Well, first, because it evokes emotions and so on. But while industrials use the second sentence? Because it conveys inevitability. You cannot choose. This is the right way. It is inevitable that things proceed in this way. There is no evaluation. You have no choice. Even if you vote, you decide indirectly legislation, so you could, in principle, also forbid robots. And just to make example, let's look at the real assertion. Larry Page, one of two co-founders of Google, some journalist, says this kind when it is asked what is Google. If it did have a category, it would be personal information. The places you have seen, communications, sensors are really cheap. Storage is cheap. Cameras are cheap. People will generate enormous amount of data. Everything you have ever heard or seen or experienced will become searchable. Your whole life will be searchable. Okay. Have you any choice? No. Do you have a choice that robots will take your place, will take your job? No. It's not true. Everything. Who asked that everything will become searchable? Here again, it is in wants to convey that the success of Google, what Google does, the services of Google, are inevitable there. Probably you have all experienced in your Windows systems that someone sometimes without asking says, oh, I've collected your pictures and made an happy movie out of them. Or that you can search like horse and you find all the horsey pictures or selfies where there are horses in your gallery of images. Did you ask someone to index your pictures in this way? No one. But it's there. It is has become searchable. And we stop here on this huge topic. As you see, I make a panorama of all the issues rather than entering in details. And I want to go back to it properly. She suggested this kind of experiment. Take Google images, look for artificial intelligence, and that's what you get. Blue brains and robots, meaning anything at all, suggesting emotionally something probably, but completely useless. She says that Google does instead shows the lithium mines, doesn't show the protests of people living nearby lithium mines, or doesn't show the exploitation of coltan miners in war territories. It doesn't show the exploitation in electronic factories of workers that sometimes are condition. It shows the huge data centers, larger than former Fiat Mirafiori factory, the biggest factory in Europe at some point. Data centers that mostly use coal generated energy with high levels of pollution. She says that that Google doesn't show you that the training sets of recognition system are based often on the mugshot from people in day, and that's probably also one of the explanation from the bias against people with skin. They don't mention the gig economy workers, like the ones employed the Amazon Mechanical Turk, labeling all the data, following mechanically some instruction and labeling like 60 pictures in 1 minute. They don't mention the people moderating the social networks, removing offending and cruel, horrible content that is uploaded in the world, and AI is not able is not able to remove. By the way, this is the title of and the affiche of a book of a movie that I suggest to have a look at. They don't mention the obsession for time in the warehouses, how machine image face recognition is used to discriminate entire population like Uyghur in China, how social networks create genocide, how automated weapons, and so on. What the main message of Kate Crawford is that, yeah, she says, it's neither artificial nor intelligence. It's not artificial because it is embodied in natural resources, in human labor. It is not autonomous at all because it's something that made, as we explained at the beginning of the lesson. And artificial, as we know, it depends entirely on a much wider set of political and social structures. And given the capitals required to build AI systems, they don't require hundreds of thousands of dollars. I was saying, given the huge amount of money, millions, to do machine learnings, these systems are at the end created and designed to serve the existing dominant interests. She says, to use the word, the expression AI is a registry of power. If you look at how artificial intelligence is made, in reality you have a list of who is in power in this moment in the world. She warns that artificial intelligence is not a purely technical domain. As we said before, bias is not a purely technical problem, but even more, the overall artificial intelligence is not a purely technical domain, because AI is connected with broader structure and social system. And given that it is a product of this power system, it reflects and produces social relations and understandings of the world. When she says AI, she means the massive industrial formation that includes politics, labor, culture and capital. And this is something that we have to consider. As also Timnit Gebru and Margaret Mitchell said in their book, big players are conditioning even the research system. We mentioned labor. Another huge topic is the one of the future of work, where on the one side people mentioned that already in the 20s of the past century, the New York Times was warning against automation. Other newspaper, other people like The Economist says, oh, look, there is an experiment showing that a coffee made and served by a robot is less tasty than, subjectively obviously, tasty than a coffee made by a bartender, so there is no risk that robots will substitute humans in workplaces. Obviously, this is a huge debate. We don't know exactly what will happen, whether there will be a shrinkage in jobs or not. But this is not the only problem, because, citing Karl Marx on alienation, he, when it was one century and a half ago, said that so automation of technology as a challenge for the individual and the society. Noticing that in the factories of his age, the person becomes an appendage of the machine, creating most monotonous work. And what happened two centuries ago with the Industrial Revolution due to AI could happen in not, let's say, physical works, but also in intellectual works, like, let's say, a doctor making a diagnosis. But there is also another issue. Many people say, every time there is a new technology, everyone is scared, but then at the end, there are more jobs than before. Take cars, when Ford created mass production of cars, well, all the people looking after horses, driving carriages, horse carriages, and so were completely out of job, but there were many more jobs available. But is the context the same? Ford inaugurated not only a new technology, but inaugurated an overall new economical system, where a worker, full-time employed, receiving maybe $5 a day, after some years, could afford the car he was building. And from that, there was, till the 70s, an explosion of work. Due to this positive feedback, more work, more money, more consumption, but is still there, this cycle? Is the new technology introducing new positive cycles or not? And we will return on this later. Beware that arguments that worked in the past depended on some context, industrial and economical and sociological context, but maybe the context is not the same. Then I would like to, maybe I have to skip some material like this one, but surely I want to mention this. There is a feedback loop also between industrialization and society. This has been, this relationship has been identified by Emile Durkheim, one of the fathers of sociology at the end of the 19th century. He noticed that specialization, division of labor in the factories Marx was talking about, in reality was not staying only inside the factory, but it was becoming an organizing principle of the overall society and creating the basis of a new social order. And the division of labor in the society, which means doctor, teacher, and so on, mayor, public administrator, or whatever, the division of roles create people that is not anymore self-sufficient. You are not a peasant with your field self-sustaining yourself. And so it creates interdependencies and reciprocities that breed mutual need, engagement, and respect. That is, they acted like a principle of with moral force, shaping the society, rendering the society more more solidary. Yet he also saw the risks, and in particular the risks of social inequality, the disruptive effect of inequality, creating extreme asymmetries of power that make conflict itself impossible, refusing to admit the right of combat. And the only solution he saw was in the primacy of politics. So since we are again in a moment where the society is changing deeply, sorry, the industry is changing deeply, we have to look at what could be the effect of these changes in the industry in our social social life, in our society. The other persons, there are two other persons to mention, the brother of Michael Polanyi, Karl Polanyi, another economist, who after the Second World War identified the fact that self-regulating markets without a guidance, without rule, run free, create problems. They are self-destructive. So again, as Emile Durkheim say, we need powerful political institutions to check what is happening in the market. And moreover, he also says that the identified the so-called commodity fictions. The fact that the market economy is rebranding some phenomena as they were part of the market, as they were just a question of price. The first is human life, reborn as labor. The second is nature, translated into land and real estate. The third was exchange, reborn as money. So this was already foreseen by Karl Marx, but Karl Polanyi further articulates this movement, and later Hannah Arendt claimed that this is a recurring cycle, a recurring phase. And to make the capitalistic work move, we need more and more cycles of appropriations. And the success of capitalism with his decade in totalitarianism, also Hannah Arendt is writing after the Second World War, was the lawlessness, the absence of law, especially in the colonies. Why I'm saying this? Because one at some point should make a question. What is the next stage? Labor, nature, exchange. What is the next stage? Let me go a little further. The next stage has been identified by Shoshana Zuboff in her very important book of a couple of years ago, The Age of Surveillance Capitalism. What is the new field of extraction is data. She says, we started with the cycle below, behavioral data, the searches you make on Google, analytics, improvement of the service. You get more important results. That was the initial success of Google, but not a monetary success, just a technical success and a success in terms of quality of service. What happened after 2001 and that provoked the success of Google? That they create another dispossession. They understood that the behavioral data in their logs, the searches I made, the click I made on these searches, were gold. They could be used to create prediction products and sold on markets on financial instruments that she calls behavioral futures and getting a huge amount of money. So, in a sense, Hannah Arendt made a prediction that after 50 years appeared true, that to continue to progress, capitalism, stuck in the crisis since the 70s, and was in 2008, got out with expropriating another dimension, the personal dimension, transforming users in person in users and not anymore customers, because who are the customers in this schema of Zuboff? The customers are the advertisers, the brands that want to sell advertising and buy future behavioral future, that is personalized spaces for to show personalized advertisement on AdWords, AdSense, on the newsfeed on Facebook, and so on. And returning to the example of Ford, this further step in capitalism, according to Shoshana Zuboff, endangers that positive cycle with all its limitation of exploitation of people, low wages, and so on, but still it led to 70 years of economical progress of the world. Now people doesn't get anymore the $5 a day to buy its T-model car. People receive free services in exchange of their behavioral data. So, according to Zuboff, we are entering in a complete different phase of capitalism. So, applying arguments like, oh, every time you introduce a technology, you say that you risk to lose job, that argument, according to Shoshana Zuboff, no, it is not applicable anymore. But I would like to arrive to the second topic of my lesson, but I would to give some more reading suggestions. Tim Wu, one of the leading lawyers in law scholars in US, inventor of the network neutrality term, the attention merchants. That is the story of how attention has been commodified, has been something that can be taken and sold, starting from the affiche in Paris in the 19th centuries, invading Paris to the personalized advertising. The master switch, about the inexplicable fact that communication and information technology since the beginning leads to monopolies, from the telegraph to the telephone to the radio to the TV and so on, always monopolies pop up. And you see Google, Facebook, Microsoft, and so on. If you want more about why monopolies are a problem, there is another book by Tim Wu, The Cures of Business, because monopolies are not just a problem for the prices. As I said, Google has no price at all, the services are free. For Tim Wu and for the people that at the beginning of the past century invented the anti-monopoly legislation, the problem was a problem with democracy. Other books, important books, are Alone Together of Sherry Turkle, about the fact that even if we are more connected, we risk to be more and more alone, where there are also the opposite view of Anthony Elliott, a sociology with the culture of AI, looking also at the positive aspects of interacting with technology. And the books of Harari summarized in How AI Could Give Rise to Tyranny article on The Atlantic a couple of years ago. Noah Harari is a historian. What is his argument? Is that due to what we just said, we are entering in an age where people, or most of the people, risks to be irrelevant. If you don't have a work, you don't count anymore. And don't forget that part of the reasons why there are democracies nowadays is that due to the dependence on workers, the powerful depended on the workers in their factory, the politicians depended on the soldiers to fight the wars, there has been a concession of power, sense of democratic power, to the majority of people. But what if wars are run by robots? What if factories are run by robots? Some people will become irrelevant, and the powerful people will more and more get back more power, and also more money, as we know. So beware. But now let's pass to the second part of the lesson. We talk up to now about the risks of AI for the society, starting from more technical ones like bias and explainability, to how AI is affecting our economy. But I want also to have the other perspective. The world is changed by AI. Is AI changing also ethics itself? And let's try to follow this argument. So when we talk about AI, we talk most often about tools for diagnosis, chatbots, searches, personalization, and whatever, autonomous cars, they are tools. But what is specific of humans, not tools? We have tools since half a million years ago. These stones are from Neanderthals, are not even from sapiens. Where has been, they went on half a million years in this way. What was the key of the success of humans? Not tools, but, to mention again Yuval Noah Harari, organization. When there has been an explosion of humans in our world, when 5,000 years ago in the Mesopotamian countries, town states create organized systems. Then after another 1,000 years, it appeared also written communication, so there was not any more oral communication. You clearly recognize this tablet. And it was due to maintaining databases of what was how much food there was, who were the owner of the land, and so on. And what was due, according to Harari, this success? This success has been due to the fact that people were able to coordinate themselves. Sorry for the background noise. Were able to coordinate themselves by fictions. They created temples of gods, and these temples were the owners of land, were the employer of peoples, and so on, so forth. Not much differently, Harari argues, from the notion of modern corporation, like Google and all the other ones. They are just creations, social creation, constructed, according to the philosopher John Searle. They are the fictions that we created to coordinate ourselves. So what is important are not the tools created, for example, by AI, but the systems of conventions that allow us to coordinate with each other. And the impact of AI is so strong that the law scholar Feng Xian from one of the most important university in China, somewhat ironically, says that AI will spell the end of capitalism. Why? Because capitalism, as we know, the market as we know, has been has born as a sort of distributed supercomputer, because there was not enough information to coordinate centrally. The market, everyone, like the economist Adam Smith claimed, you simply do what seems selfish to you, and an invisible hand will make the economy progress. Why? Because there is no alternative. There is no invisible hand, obviously, but it was impossible, and that was the error of socialists for Hayek, to have a planned economy, because you didn't have enough data, you didn't have enough computational power. And now we have. So we really are in a moment where things can seriously change. So when we talk about regulating algorithm, really we don't regulate, you cannot regulate an algorithm. An algorithm is an abstract entity. We cannot regulate an algorithm as we cannot regulate that 1 + 1 makes 2. We can regulate the application of algorithms, but we have to be careful on two things. Many scholars, like for example Luciano Floridi and others, propose to regulate AI simply taking the best of existing ethics. In particular, the more complex applied ethics up to now is ethics in the biomedical field, where you have to decide the serious things like killing a person because he's too ill, or killing a fetus in the womb. So you understand the problem are serious, and so there has been a lot of research, the most modern and agreed upon vision is expressed in the book by Bisham and Childress, Principle of Biomedical Ethics. So these authors say, just take what the biomedical ethicists said and bring the four principles of biomedical ethics within AI. But again, bringing arguments in another context without looking how the context is different is very risky. And in particular, we have to look at all the differences between the biomedical setting and the application of AI setting, starting from the role of companies. In biomedical ethics, we have bioengineering companies creating products used by doctors and so on. It's a completely different sector with respect to AI, where you have big monopolies providing services that are ubiquitous in our lives. Doctors has the power to decide whether to kill or not someone. We programmers don't have. If you are in a big company, a programmer in a big company, you work with thousands of other people, you don't have the overall picture of what is happening. So apart from cases like the one of Gebru Mitchell, there are very, very few examples of workers complaining for the decision taken within IT companies, because they don't know the overall picture. So the settings are completely different. So we need a new ethics. We don't simply leverage of what bioethicist has made up to now. But there is a farther issue. The four principles of biomedical ethics are like the beneficence principle. You don't have to do evil. You have to do good. The non-maleficent. You don't have to do evil. The autonomy principle. But does these principles still applicable in a world with AI? If, as we said, AI can do things that are much better, it can do things much in a much better way than we do. And we, in some situations, like a medical situation, a diagnosis, we leave to the AI system to decide, well, we could also, at some point, imagine a situation where to decide what is beneficent, what is good in a certain situation, so how to follow the principle, the ethical principle of beneficence, is demanded to AI, and the same for maleficence. So at some point, we arrive as a circular situation, which we have ethical principles that are applied to AI, but to apply these principles, we need AI itself, because to understand if application of AI is ethical, to have under control all the different variables in a complex world, we have to resort to AI itself, or to avoid using the best technologies we have to take a decision in a complex situation. So we are really at a troublesome point. And also another principle of medical bioethics is the autonomy once, which means the doctor must decide autonomously after having informed the patient, so-called informed consent, and the patient has all the element to decide autonomously and to say to the doctor whether to undergo an operation or not. And Floridi and others propose to use the same thing for AI system. If we have an AI tool, well, we must be able to be autonomous. We must be able to switch off the AI system and continue deciding ourselves. But think of a complicated airplane driven by AI. Could you simply switch off the AI system and decide yourself to drive the airplane? No, it's too complicated. So again, autonomy doesn't work. Beside the four principles of medical bioethics, Floridi proposes also explainability as a further principle. But we already said enough about explainability. So it really seems that we are at a changing point for ethics. As Professor Mori explained you in details in the two previous lessons, this is not uncommon. Bioethic itself, even if with less invasive technologies, required a completely revision of traditional ethics, the ethic of absolutes and so on, as he said. And are we again, after 50 years from the born of bioethics, are we again in the same situation, where even worse, where we have a current approach to ethics that is to be circular and to pretend to regulate AI while at the same time resorting to AI to make ethical decisions. So that's the situation. I was just to conclude to remember, like Algorithmic Watch at the beginning, there are many initiatives also outside the academy to make people aware of the risks of AI, the need that politics regulate AI, like Big Brother Watch, Algorithmic Justice League, and so on. Fight of the Future, there are a campaign to stop killer robots. So there are many, many advocacies group in this sense, and this is also the rationale behind our society. And that's all, hoping that as the former CEO of Google, Eric Schmidt, and one of the chief scientists in machine learning say, let's stop freaking out about artificial intelligence, or maybe not. So I took, I guess, most of the time. We are left with a very few minutes for discussion, but also we can also stay after the time clock if there is need. Is there anyone who has questions?
Guido, I'm Maria Francesca Costabile from University of Bari. Francesca. I would like to ask a question. I have to excuse me because I have another meeting at 4:30, so that's why I may not stay too long. So first of all, thank you very much for the course you organized. Thank you very much for your very interesting talk. We realized that there is a lot to do on ethics and AI. But I want to go back to something that Maurizio Mori said in his lecture. You were also at that lecture, so I think you can just maybe comment on that. He said something that impressed me very much. He said that artificial intelligence will eliminate that centrality of human beings. So I was a bit breathed and maybe even scared about this. I didn't have a good connection in the two previous lectures, so I could not discuss it with Maurizio Mori. But I mean, to me, I think that as researchers, we have the duty to work in order to avoid that the centrality of human beings will be eliminated. I think we, if we work on this, we can succeed on this. You know, all the current emphasis on AI is pushing some researchers to work on human-centered AI. In particular, Ben Schneiderman, who is a well-known researcher in human-computer interaction, is proposing a two-dimensional framework of human-centered artificial intelligence that separates levels of automation from levels of human control. So he seeks a high level of human control as well as a high level of automation. Actually, this problem of control arises also in a book of an AI leader like as Stuart Russell. He has just published a book just in 2019. He published a book titled Human Compatible, Artificial Intelligence and the Problem of Control. So I think, do you hear me?
Yes.
I think I lost you. Okay, no. So I think that we have to devote our effort to create machines that first of all are beneficial to human beings, that human beings can control. So I would like to know your opinion on this and how this expression of Maurizio Mori should be interpreted. Artificial intelligence will eliminate the centrality of human beings.
Okay, thanks for your question. And also I would like to reveal to the audience that the very idea of having a PhD course on this topic is actually of Francesca and not of Sipeia. Thanks, has been really a good idea with more than 100 people registered. I don't know exactly what Professor Mori meant, but I would like to go back to a slide that I missed, I had to skip. Because I said, Emile Durkheim discovered that the industrial organization has an impact and is reflected in the organization of the society. And my intention was to complete his argument looking at what the top enterprises see as an evolution of the industry, of the economics. And if you take the CEO of Microsoft, Satya Nadella, in a famous speech at Build 2017, he says, now there is edge computing, now there is AI in every machine, in every production machine, in every factory. It's a pity that we should make try and error learning in each factory on the data available only in that factory. We should do this way. You factory give to me, Microsoft, your data all over the world, all the factories. We learn and we give you back the trained neural network that can perform best in your factory, in the production machines. So what he's foreseeing is a sort of hive, in the meaning of bees, hive of the bees, where there is a queen bee and controlling everything, and all the knowledge is coming from one or few sources. But if this will be the model in industry, and if Emile Durkheim is right, we will have this hive model back into the organization of society. And so I would agree that there is the risk of putting aside human being and from the center of this world, at least not the, let's say, the non-powerful, not enough powerful human beings. And I guess it is time to reread, as I did, books like Brave New World of Aldous Huxley, who is claiming that you cannot be happy and free at the same time, or George Orwell, whose idea is not just a critic of socialism and communism, it is a critic of technology. It says that technologies used by power reduce freedom. And I'm quite a pessimist in this sense. I'm also don't agree that we can have control in the sense of the human-centered AI. I think that what we have to do is to act at the political level to enforce the primacy of politics. We have in our hands the tool to regulate, but not the technology. We have to regulate the industry applying technologies. And in this sense, I agree with Piero Poccianti, the president of Italian Association for Artificial Intelligence. The new draft of regulation on AI by the European Parliament doesn't go in this way. They are too focused on the technology like face recognition, but not on the overall risk at the economic level and the risk that the transformation goes to the society. And I agree, we as researchers should promote this alert.
Yes, thank you very much. Of course, so we have to promote this, but I'm slightly more optimistic than you are optimistic, because I think that we have to try to build machines that, first of all, are beneficial to human beings, that, you know, they work in order to achieve the objectives that are of human beings. And, you know, I work on human computer interaction, and I strongly believe on the synergy of human computer interaction and AI in order to still keep the centrality of human beings. Anyway, the discussion could be too long, and I thank you very much, you, for organizing this course. I suggested the course because in Bari we have several students on AI, and I believe this topic, ethics and AI, is really very, very important. So that's why, yes, I asked you for this course, and I thank you for your enthusiasm in accepting it, and I hope that all students will appreciate it. I'm sure they will. Thank you very much.
Now, thanks to you, Francesca. Is there any other question? As you know, on Thursday we have the final lesson with a different approach, because Professor Gianni Sartor is a law scholar. So we'll provide a third different interdisciplinary approach. Please. Okay. No more questions. So, as you have seen, I put in the website the recordings as soon as they are ready, and the slides, and see you on Thursday. Thanks to every one of you for your attention. Bye. And if you have questions later, just write to me or to my colleagues. Bye. Bye.